heart, keep those you have given me true to your name, so that they may be one like us. Consecrate them in the truth. Your word is truth. I have sent thee into the world, I have sent them into the world, and for their sake I consecrate myself, so that they too may be consecrated in truth. I pray not only for these, but also for those who through their teaching will come to believe in me. May they all be one, just as Father, you are in me and I am in you, so that the world may believe it was you who sent me. With me and them, and you and me, may they be so perfected in unity that the world will recognize that it was you who sent me, and that you have loved them as you have loved me. And this is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As what he's going and saying, Edmund, he says, You wait for them, and they wait for you. And that's how it turned out for my duration here. When I left you in August 69, I certainly could confirm Father Comey's assessment of you. You are helpful and decent and hardworking, and I told you so. Now, I never did expect to be back on this altar again, talking to you. Maybe I said yes too easily to Father Collins when he asked me. Maybe I gave in too quickly to his plea to the parish council to ask me to come back. I don't know. It's not that I don't like Father Collins. I think he's a great, hard-working man. And I don't know one on his parish committee. But then I'm not sure if I like parish committees. And that may go back to an episode that happened and I heard about. There was this parish who had a parish committee, and they were like these tyrant long plans to get overactive. They hired him, they hassled him, they pushed him, they mooted, they shoved, they dumped, and they changed. But the poor man was carted off in a hurry to hospital. And when he was in the hospital, chairman of the parish council called to see him. And he assured the priest, he says, you get well, Father. I know you will. Because he says, last night we had a very meeting of the parish council and we decided by 6-4 to pray for your recovery. But it's really good to be here this year, to be here on this big day. You are rejoicing on the double. You are commemorating the 150 years of St. Mary's. And you are showing off, in no mean fashion, this very beautiful and unbelievable transformation that you wrought and brought about in this church. We thank God with you for all his kindness to this area and to you over the past 150 years. And we congratulate you on this wonderful achievement. No doubt it had been a hard work for Father Collins, but for due generosity and your staunch support, the renovations and additions have been assured a labor of love for him. And you yourselves are rightly and justifiably proud of what through you has been achieved here. But remember, a great example had been set and handed down to you. Did your forebears carry the stones to build the first St. Mary's? And did they support it in hard, famine times and through many lean years? And did some of you here and many of your kids came almost rebuild the St. Mary's, certainly you extended it, you beautified it, and you made it a great church at the time, and it cost you £8,000. Now £1,000 doesn't seem much to us now, but that £8,000 would be worth about £400,000 in today's money. And didn't you subscribe generously to me when in 1964 I visited your houses and collected money for the renovations of the curate's house? I tell you now, that was the most hardest and most embarrassing collection I ever had to make. But you received me kindly and you were generous and good. They will make me a sanctuary, and I will dwell in the midst of them. God said to Moses in the desert. And this sanctuary, called the tabernacle, was the first ever church was built on your earth to worship the true God. And the architect of that church was none other than God himself. Of all the commandments that God did give to Moses, there were none more formal or more precise than these which concern the building of the tabernacle. Its size, its shape, its form were very clearly defined. The smallest detail was the into, and lavish magnificence is demanded in the finished structure. The Ark of the Covenant, which was housed inside that tabernacle, had to be made of incorruptible wood and painted the finest gold within and without. The vestments were detailed, and the incense was specified. Now this was God's own blueprint for the first church. And remember, this church was a mobile church. It was time that the Jews, in their wandering into the promised lands, were set down as a factory. About 1,000 years before Christ came, Solomon built a temple in Jerusalem. It was the first permanent church. It was modeled on the tabernacle. It was much, much greater, but it too was dazzlingly magnificent. Now, despite the grandeur of both the tabernacle and the temple, your own church here in Bruskey far outshines the Lord, because Christ lives here sacramentally, and he didn't live thuswise either in the tabernacle or in the temple. And since he does live here, and you are his follower and friends, your lives should and must revolve around this church. It was just not meant to be admired, neither was it built as a landmark. It was built for the glory of God. It was built so that you and generations of children yet unborn could come ever nearer and closer to him. You will meet in a very special way here. The prayer you say here will have special efficacy. And the use you make of it will spell out your happiness in this world and in the next. To each child brought here from baptism, the priest on meeting the child of the door will say, "The Christian community welcomes you with great joy. In its name I claim you for Christ our Savior, for the sign of the cross I now place on your foreheads." A splash of water and some simple words, and that claim is ratified by God himself. He adopts that baby, he sees it for himself, and loves it exactly as he loves his own son. And when your lifespan is ended, and your names are being taken from the church, God's priest will be, may the angels lead you into paradise. In the year between these two events, it's what you do here and its influence on your life that will give meaning and assurance to that last day. Parents will bring their children here and tell them whose house it is, who lived in the tabernacle on the altar, the story of the station of the cross, what the crucifix means, and at Christmas will explain to wondering and innocent eyes what the crib is all about. Here the children will list their first confessions. Here you will admit to the folly of youth, him, you will accuse your head of the liberal breach of God's law. Knowing that in every case, the verdict will come down in your favor, in the favor of a contrite and humble heart. At this altar here, your children and children to come will offer and will receive the first holy communion. And you and me will come Sunday after Sunday to offer with the priest the sacrament of the Mass. Now a sacrifice says something, and it must mean something. My sacrifice in yours. And when the gifts have been brought to the altar, we very often say, Lord, accept these gifts that we offer. And when the bread and wine goes like that, our hopes, our fears, our doubts, and our worries, our favors, and our thanks, and above all, our love should go with these gifts to be offered to God. There is just no one in this church today who can offer your love to God except yourself. Take our bread we ask you, take our hearts we love you, take our mind, O Father, they are yours. Now God does accept these gifts, and in return he gives us not something but somebody. This is the Lamb of God. Some people say they have found the Mass boring, and some people say they get nothing out of the Mass. Ever feel like that, the faith you have to test is not the Mass to the fall. Children, of course, do get spanked. I heard recently of a parent who brought a young lad to church for the first time in 4.5 years. And the warned him and cautioned him he had to be very quiet in church. And he sat down, and his eyes got riveted on the sanctuary lamp. And he sat there, watched the sanctuary lamp, and the angel popped in his head. And after a long time, he said in a whisper to his mother, it could be heard, Mammy, he said, when that turns green, can we go home? Thank you. one young pastor here, we are to offer his first mass at this altar. It happened many times before in this area. It happened in my time here. I can recall four houses in this area from which there came two priests each, and a number of houses from which there came one. Is our prayers lacking, or is our faith gone cold? But could you imagine Bruskey without a church? You probably could. But then, what's a church if there's no priest to serve at that church? We pray that that would never happen, but the danger is that it could. And I know today on Mission Sunday, in prayer for the priest on the mission, and I know that not many of us probably will be top of the box, top of the list, in your pray for him, and for all the other ministries of working in Africa. And here too, you will pray for your dead. They again cried out to us, have pity on me, at least you, my friends, for the hand of God is with me. And you remember when St. Monica was dying in Rome and Augustine, her son, was waiting for taking her body back and waiting to bury her. She said to him, there's only one request I ask of you before I die, and that is, if you remember me, bear a memory of this at the altar of God. So we pray for the people, our friends, and we pray for the priests who served here over the past 50 years. Within these hollowed walls lies the remains of a native son, Father Peter Hoffman. Somewhere on a battlefield in France lies the remains of a chaplain, Father Stephen Sharp, who was a priest here. We pray for them, and when you're praying for the past priest, you might fall fighting for the one who's still there. Now, when you're asked to go and speak at the end of Mass, to go back to your families and pray together, when the Pope was leaving Ireland in 79, he said at Limerick, may your homes all remain homes of prayer. The traditional prayer in Bruskey was the rosary. Our Lady came down from heaven a number of times and asked it. The church preaches it, and we all worship it. And there are a couple of times the questions I would ask just before I leave, have you got a rosary? Because I know of a family and they're going to borrow a rosary bead from the man in the house dying, to make a respectable of him in the week. The second thing, have your children got rosary beads? They have television, they have radio, they have Walkman, they have telescope, and they have all the other things that have rosaries, and they use them together. And I put this especially in the name because of something that happened during the mission. Once during the mission was around the houses, trying to build up enthusiasm for the mission. And within this house, and there was cultural and white, a brother called Bruskey, a him and a horror. And horror was the boss. She did all the talking, she did all the answers, she'd be on the mission the next morning, the application, no doubt about it. And going out the door, the missioner saw beads hung up on a nail. And he said, ah, he said, I see you say the rosary. And she scowled and she looked at the missioner, she looked at him, and she says, Father, she says, then it is babies, and they're the babies that the baby claims. Now, I kept it long enough, and I know you won't ask me back again, but I want, before I leave, to give Father Cullerman, Father Cullerman, and thank you all, Father Cullerman's comments, and he's very highly skilled and most efficient architect. something like this. He's done a wonderful job. But it was him and our colleagues. You are an invisible people. You hand over the cost to the children. It's great to see you again. May God bless you with good health. And may you live long to pray and visit in this beautiful church, this sanctuary which you have made for the glory of God.
Lord, Today, we want to say thanks for 150 years. St. Mary's has not only stood the test of time, but even improved with age. Johnny carries a flame, a symbol of the recent refurbishment, which has beautified our church and created an atmosphere conducive to prayer. The faith of the people of Bruskey has always found expression in their generous support of the church. In just over 12 months, we ourselves have contributed more than £40,000 towards St. Mary's. The collection basket carried by Tosh is a symbol of the generosity of past and present parishioners. This bread, which is carried by Ailey, will be changed into the body of Christ, our nourishment for life's journey. And as we share the bread of life together around the Lord's table, we are sent forth by Christ to offer the bread of friendship to one another. Wine is a symbol of joy, but the chalice is a reminder of suffering. As Sister Eileen carries the chalice of wine to the altar, we are offering our lives interwoven with happiness and pain. This wine will be changed into the blood of Christ, through whose wounds we are healed.
Thank you. sacrifice. Welcome into your kingdom our departed brothers and sisters, and all who have left this world in your friendship. We hope to enjoy forever the vision of your glory, through Christ our Lord, from whom all good things come.
Amen.
historic day for St. Mary's Bruskey. Many of you have come a distance to be with us. We're delighted that you are able to join us. And I'd like to express a very warm welcome to our Protestant friends whom I see in the congregation, and we're very glad that you have come. I'm particularly happy to welcome, and I can say now, welcome back, Bishop McKernan. He has done us a great honour in being chief celebrant of this Mass of Thanksgiving. And I would like to thank him also for the kind words that he has spoken. Thank you very much, Bishop. For him and I. Bruskey has had many distinguished curates, none more so than our humblest of today, Monsignor Edward Inch. His memory does live on, very much so in this area, and it will certainly go into history after today. Thank you very much, Monsignor, for your work. Very good that you've been able to join us. Okay. Next day, I mentioned the name of some of the parish, Father Gerard Smith and Father Bill Brady. And our former curate, Bill McCormick, Patsy and Patsy Salt. Getting our present curate, my good colleague, Canon Peter. Is it amazing how we all look up to you? Peter Paul and Frankie send their apologies. I'd like to also welcome the neighbouring priests who have come and my golfing friends. They're here. They're coming up every week, there. So if I'm looking for an increase in the Jews on this, I think we'll blame them. Many sisters have joined us here too, and we're delighted that you've been able to come, especially our local sisters, Eileen and Vera O'Haverty. It's a beautiful girl away from here.
£15,000.
Wasn't that extraordinary? So what can you say of the people to add my word. The choir is the Band Temple Parish Choir, directed by Agnes Grady, our organist, Andrew Sheridan, soloist Archie Grove, David Shanahan, gathered from Hockney, Bruskey, and Aberdeen. They played very well, don't they? They turned out so beautifully, and we marched into the strains of the Irish Rover, didn't we? They were lovely. Thank you very much indeed, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Camera's in the game. The car's not happy. You put it out through it. stand back. Okay. Just stand back. Stand back for a second.
Okay, that's a good idea.